Child of God, I greet you in the name of Jesus Christ. I'm Pastor Felu Moshesan, the host of Living by Grace. I believe one of the greatest gifts that the Lord has given us as Christians is the gift of grace. For with the grace of God, are we able to live the life that God has blessed us with in Christ Jesus. The life that we have in Christ Jesus is a good life, a beautiful life, enviable life. It's a powerful life. According to the scripture, it's a life that is empowered to reign and dominate. But we need grace if we are going to be able to live this life in this world at this time. And that's why I'm excited that God, in His infinite mercy, has made you to listen to me and several other members of the family of grace all over the world for today's broadcast. For through today's broadcast, you will be engraced to live the life that you have in Christ. And so shall it be for you, in Jesus' name, amen. Welcome back. Today, by the grace of God, our topic is engaging grace in the battles of life. Engaging grace in the battles of life. And we shall be looking at the account of 1 Kings chapter 18 from verse 42 to 46 as our case study. The account of Ahab and Prophet Elijah on Mount Carmel. That's what we shall be looking at. We want to do a case study of the two of them to see how engaging the grace of God in the battles of life is possible. And the result for engaging the grace of God versus the result for engaging the harm of the flesh. Again, our topic is engaging the grace of God in the battles of life. Let's take our test. 1 Kings chapter 18, I read from verse 42. Let's start from verse 41. Then Elijah said, O Ahab, go up, eat and drink, for there is the sound of abundance of rain. So Ahab went up to eat and drink, and Elijah went up to the mountaintop. Then he bowed down on the ground and put his face between his knees and said to his servant, go up now, look toward the sea. So he went up and looked and said, there is nothing. Seven times he said, go again. Verse 44. Then it came to pass the seventh time that he said, there is a cloud as small as a man's hand rising out of the sea. So he said, go up, say to Ahab, prepare your chariot and go down before the rain stops you. Now it happened in the meantime that the sky became dark with clouds and wind, and there was a heavy rain. So Ahab rode away and went to Jezreel. Verse 46, the last verse. Then the hand of the Lord came upon Elijah. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I pray for you. In this seventh month of the year 2021, that we call the month of July, the hand of the Lord is upon you. And by the hand of the Lord, you will realize every goal that you have set according to the promise of God to achieve for this month in Jesus' name. Amen. Then the hand of the Lord came upon Elijah, and he girded up his loins and ran ahead of Ahab to the entrance of Jezreel. May the Lord bless the reading of his word in Jesus' name. Amen. Life is made up of series of unfolding events. That's the characteristics of life. Life is made up of series of unfolding events. Look at it. After this event, the next event, the next event, the next event. That's what life is made up of. A series of unfolding events. Some of these events are desirable, why some of them are not. But for a Christian, whatever life unfolds unto you at any point in time, whether desirable or not, you are expected to deal with it in obedience to God. You are expected to deal with the unfolding events of life according to the word of the Lord. Deal with it in the consciousness of God. Deal with it out of fear and respect for God. That is expected of every Christian. Whether the event that is unfolding at this point in time is desirable or not, the expectation that God has for you by virtue of his life and his spirit in you is that you deal with it according to the word of God. Psalm 1 verse 1, it says, blessed is the man that sits not, that stands not, that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, but instead meditates on the word of God day and night, that he might order his ways accordingly. So irrespective of the event that unfolds or is unfolding or will unfold unto you, child of God, the expectation that God has of you is that you deal with it according to his word. Now, how do you deal with the events of life according to the word of God? That's where grace comes in. You see, child of God, the Lord engraced you that you might be able. See, the purpose of grace is empowerment. Another word for engracement is empowerment. So to be engraced is to be empowered. So by virtue of your salvation and the giving unto you of the Holy Spirit, you have received power to be able to deal with the events of life according to the word of God. That's why in Acts chapter 1 verse 8, the Lord said, you will receive power after the Holy Spirit is come upon you. So that with that power, whether you find yourself in Jerusalem or in Judah or in Samaria or anywhere, symbolically saying, whatever situation life unfolds, whether pleasant, unpleasant, desirable or undesirable, praiseworthy or not, it is expected of you to deal with every situation as a representative of God, righteously, faithfully, justly, obediently, and with the fear of God. So grace is upon your life as an empowerment for you to use to deal with life according to the word of God. Now, however, to carry grace and not be able to deal with the challenges of life according to the word of God, it's not different from not carrying grace. If a man, a Christian, confronts the challenges of life in disobedience to God, he compromises, he backslides, he fails in the face of the challenges of life, that Christian carries grace and still ends up dealing with the challenges of life contrary to the word of God, it's not different from anybody that does not carry grace. So you are expected to dispense grace. You are expected to fall back on God's grace upon your life. You are expected to pull out grace and use it to deal with whatever life serves you. That's the reason why God gave you grace. So to now not deal with the challenges of life according to the grace of God, and therefore begin to fall into sin, is to render grace useless in your life. But that will not be your portion in the name of Jesus Christ. And so the purpose of today's exhortation, according to the topic, is to reveal to us how to engage grace, the grace we already carry, how to deploy grace when we find ourselves at the battlefront of life. And once again, I pray for you, you will not fail in the name of Jesus Christ. Before we look into it, I want you to know that the reason why we find shame, reproach, and ridicule in the testimony of some children of God borders around what I'm about to share with you. It is not that there is no grace in our lives. It is that many of us do not know how to engage the grace of God. And by the study of today, you will begin to know, and you will go forth to do that in Jesus' name. Let's look at the study. In the story we read, there are four things I want you to observe. For example, number one, in verse 42 to 44, you will see that before the abundance, there was the gathering of the dark cloud. That's the first thing I want you to notice. Before the abundance, there was the gathering of the dark cloud. And that is true about life. You know, most cases, child of God, the blessings of God is usually in the womb of trial. Trial is the womb through which the blessings of God are birthed. In most cases, in this case, before the abundance that Elijah said he saw, or he heard the sound of, there was the gathering of cloud. And both Elijah and King Ahab, they had to travel through that cloud before they could get to Jezreel, the place where the abundance is supposed to be for them. Note, child of God, that before the abundance that the Lord has promised you, there usually is a cloud of darkness that gathers that you should pass through. And it is for that cloud of darkness that God gave you grace so that you can pass through it successfully and not lose your way or lose your life in the gathered darkness. So that you can go through it and make it to your own Jezreel, the place of the abundance. Again, note that before the place of abundance, there is always a cloud of darkness that you will need to pass through. It may be delay, it may be disappointment, it may be betrayal, it may be lack. Whatever be your own cloud of darkness that you are going through now, I want you to know that the grace to go through it is already in your life. And you are expected to engage that grace so that with the grace of God, you can go through your cloud of darkness successfully and make it to your Jezreel, the place of your abundance. With the grace of God, as you go through this darkness, you will see that you will not compromise. You will see that you will not fall into sin. You will see that you will always be able to obey God, little by little, step by step. That is why you carry grace for such a time as this. Mordecai said to Esther, for such a time as this is why God has placed you in the palace. Esther there represents grace, the grace that God has made available for that time. That by the operation of that grace, Israel can go through that phase and come to their place of abundance. In the name of Jesus Christ, Every form of grace in your life for this time you are going through, may you be able to effectively and efficiently engage them. You will go through this phase, brother. You will go through this phase, sister, and you will not soil your testimony by the grace of God. You will not soil your testimony by the grace of God. And the place of your abundance, you will make it there in the name of Jesus Christ. So number one, you need to know that for you to be able to engage the grace of God, know that before the place of abundance, there will be the gathering of dark clouds that you should go through. Number two, you need to know. That the presence of grace, according to verse 38, that the presence of grace preceded the coming of the cloud. There was grace before there was the cloud. Look at verse 38. In verse 38, in answer to Elijah's prayer, the fire came down. And everybody saw the fire and the work of the fire. The fire symbolized God. It was after verse 38 that we now got verse 42 to 44. What is the lesson, dear child of God? I need you to know, God wants you to know, that before whatever cloud of darkness you are going through came, the grace of God had come earlier. So before the cloud, there was the grace. Because God will not allow you to be tempted by situations and circumstances that is beyond the power he has given you. That's 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. So, child of God, you have grace for such a time as this. Engage it. For this reason, as God engraced you before now, that when now comes, you'll be able to go through it as a child of God. Point number two. Before the storm, there was the grace. Note that as you fight the battles of life in Jesus' name. Point number three. The third thing I want you to know is that a relationship between God of grace and Elijah existed before the cloud came, according to verse 42. But such a relationship did not exist between God and King Ahab. If you are going to be able to engage grace, see, grace of God is not activities. It's not fasting. It's not going to church. Behind the grace of God is God. It is the presence of God that makes the grace of God effectual. It's not our activities. It's not in the number of days that you are fasting. Not the severity of your fast, dry charge. No. Those are activities of grace. The real spirit of grace is God. For you cannot experience the grace of God if you don't have the relationship with the God of grace. So according to verse 42, Elijah already had a relationship with the God of grace, which Ahab did not. And so when the dark cloud arose, Elijah was able to draw down on his relationship with God. And that was why God made grace available for him. See, I want to pray for you. In case you don't have a relationship with the God of grace because of sin or worldliness, as you are hearing me, May the Spirit of the Lord that is upon this message convict you and cause you to turn and give your life to Jesus. Because it is through Jesus that we get into a relationship with the God of grace. You need a relationship with the God of grace so that you can access the grace of God in these times of darkness that you are going through. Elijah had it. Ahab had it not. And that was why it was Elijah that overtook Ahab, even when Elijah had no chariot, the God of grace engraced Elijah. And that which Elijah had, his leg, became sufficient to take him through and made it to Jezreel with Ahab coming behind him. In the name of Jesus, you will beat all competitions to the price. In the name of Jesus, everyone that is in competition with you for the price, you will beat them, because grace will make it happen for you in Jesus' name. Lastly, if you are going to be able to engage the grace of God, then we need to talk about consciousness. Another word for consciousness is awareness. In verse 45, when Elijah announced to Ahab that darkness is gathering, the Bible said Ahab turned to his chariots to run with through the cloud. But verse 46 said, while Ahab turned to his chariots, Elijah turned to God. So Ahab ran in chariots through the dark cloud, while Elijah ran in the hand of God. Because verse 46 said, Ahab turned to his chariots, Elijah turned to the hand of God. And that was why it was Elijah that overtook Ahab to get to the place of abundance. Listen to me. What are you conscious of in your present situation? Because you see, child of God, it is consciousness that creates reality. Believe me sincerely. Another word for consciousness is awareness. Another word we may use for it is imaginations. You know, what are you conscious of where you are now? Because it is consciousness that will create your realities. Whether you are going to make it or you are going to fail, whether you are going to succeed or you are going to be defeated, whether you are going to be victorious or not, is according to your consciousness. That's why Jesus said, as a man thinketh in his heart. Another way of saying is, see, whatever a man is conscious of, that is what he will get. He said, you shall decree a thing, and it shall be established unto you. Meaning, by your consciousness, you are decreeing your destination. Elijah was full of the thoughts of God, and God made available grace that delivered the destination. Ahab, in his case, he was confident in his chariots. His faith, his trust were in his chariot. And that was why he came behind Elijah. What are you conscious of? What do you see? In the testimony of the woman with the issue of blood, the woman got healing according to her thinking. She said, if I can touch the hem of his garment, I will be healed. That was even before he came to Jesus. The man with leprosy in Matthew chapter 8, before he came to Jesus, he had said it in his mind that if he will touch him, he will be cleansed. And so by the time he got to Jesus and he said it, Jesus said, I will be clean. Listen to me, child of God. Do you want to engage the grace of God that is in your life to deliver the promises of God for you? One of the ways we engage the grace of God is by being conscious in our present situation of the destination that God promised us, against all the odds that this situation is telling us. Consciousness of a destination that is promised by God is the key to engaging the grace of God. I leave you with these few points to reflect over. Number one, I'd like you to know that to engage the grace of God, you must know that prior to challenge, there has been grace. Number two, you must know that a relationship with the God of grace is a requisite to engaging the grace of God. Number four, you must also know that before the abundance, there is always the gathering of the cloud, and that the grace of God that is given to you, you are expected to use it to go through the crowd and come unto your place of abundance. Until I see you next Wednesday, keep living under the atmosphere of grace. The Lord bless you. Let us pray. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus. According as we have learned today, we receive grace to engage grace. Yes, grace to engage grace, to go through the dark gathering of clouds and come to our place of commanded blessings. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. God bless you.